possible. But to get a flavour of what it was like in the early years, let's see some of the highlights of the 60s and the people who presented them, like that doyen of commentators, Mícheál O Hehir, and the great horse, Arkell.
As far as the jumping season was concerned, this was Arkell's year.
It's Milhouse on the inside, jumps it only just ahead of Arkell. Now they're rounding the home turn, and this is it. And Willie Robinson's got his whip out, and Pat Taff is shaking up Arkell. And this is the race now to the last fence. It's Arkell on the stand side for Ireland and Milhouse for England on the far side. And this is it, with Arkell just taking the lead as they come to the last fence. It's going to be Arkell if he jumps it. Arkell coming to the last now, and Arkell a length clear of Milhouse. He's over and clear. Milhouse is trying to challenge him again, but it's Arkell on the stand side. Milhouse over on the far side, coming up towards the line, and Arkell is holding him. Arkell going away now from Milhouse. This is the champion. This is the best we've seen for a long time. Arkell is the winner of the World Cup. Milhouse is second.
The Irish public saw plenty of Arkell too, and they cheered him in force in the Irish Grand National at Ferry House.
Reaching out of the final fence, Arkell and Height of Fashion together. And it's Arkell just the leader. And in the race home now, it's Arkell. Arkell and Height of Fashion, very little between them. And Pat Taff pushing Arkell out. Height of Fashion trying to bear him down on him. But racing down now at 50 yards to go, it's Arkell. And coming down to the finishing post, it is Arkell. That's his one. And there he goes, the undisputed champion. Arkell the winner. Height of Fashion is second. And Ferry Boat is third.
In hurling, after Cork had shown some early round signs of a comeback, Tipperary won the Munster title with brilliant ease. And in Leinster, Kilkenny qualified for yet another All-Ireland appearance in defence of their title.
Locked down by Tony Wall for Tip, and Tony Wall high upfield with the ball. Pat Henderson doesn't get there. Liam Devaney is in possession. Liam Devaney, the star of many a Tipperary team, off for a long time because of injury, but right in the game now. Get it into Sean McLaughlin, and Donny Neenan, it's the goal! It's the goal! It's the goal for Tipperary, as the goalkeeper and the backs were watching Sean McLaughlin. In came Donny Neenan, and from the edge of the parallelogram, just outside that 5-yard line, he tapped the ball into the net and sent Tipperary into the lead, 2-10 to 1-7, after 10 minutes of play in the second half. But back come Kilkenny again. Penny Moran, our check card is beaten by Babs Keating, and Babs' shot from the halfway line is good. It's over the bar.
On that day, the striped, jerseyed men of Kilkenny just couldn't cope with the brilliance of Tipperary, whose 5-13 to 2-8 victory won them their 20th All-Ireland title, and a personal triumph for John Doyle, who now has won 7 senior titles.
In soccer, 1964 was the year of great achievement for League of Ireland clubs and players. Shamrock Rovers started it with the Cup and League double to complete a grand slam of the 5 major trophies.
What's some of the air by John? Ambrose heads it out to Tui. If he can get to it, he does. He heads it further away. Donovan gets it back for Celtic. Leahy is there. Noonan is there. Joe gets it away for Rovers. Joe carrying the ball away for Rovers, turning it out to Byrne. And Rovers move away out of their own danger area, their own goal area. Byrne inside of Joe, coming up an attack as a sixth forward. Joe on to Jackie Mooney. Mooney kills the ball. Slide passes it out to Tony Byrne. Byrne back inside to Mooney. Mooney to Joe. Edge of the box. Joe. Joe into Mooney. Mooney scambles, gets the ball back to Eddie Bale of a shot. And there's a goal! Oh, there's a big goal! 2-1, Eddie Bellum, a terrific goal for Rovers. They lead 2-1.
The European Cup games against Spain were a sad disappointment, despite the fact that our conquerors did eventually win the Cup. And later defeat by England was hardly a hopeful sign for the future. But the tide turned in the last international of the year when defeat by Poland on the continent was fully avenged by a splendid win in the return match at Elephant Park. It was a game that was a personal triumph for Andy McEvoy, and he scored one of the greatest goals ever seen in Delamont.
Come on, Jackie, get up to that!
All right, Joe! Ready up.
Ooh. No harm done. Mooney on the ball for Ireland. Nice to Hennessy. McEvoy's in there! Carnick is in!
traditionally, Ireland's rugby internationals begin with the match against England. And although the venue was Twickenham this year, the thrills and excitement of that first game were brought to a vast audience throughout Ireland through live television. And we scored our first win at Twickenham since 1948. A feature of the game was the play of young Mike Gibson, who played the vital role in two fine tries in that game.
Murphy gives the ball to Kelly. Bald head of Ford peering over the scrum there to know which way will Ireland go. A beautiful heel by Dawson. Kelly making a break, a reverse pass. And there's Gibson trying to go through. He jinks past one man. He links up with Murphy. A score for Ireland. What a wonderful try by Murphy. Well, well, well. And again, the man to do it, Mike Gibson. A beautiful reverse scissors movement with Kelly. And after 31 minutes in the first half, Ireland lead by 3 points, and there is the man who scored the try, Noel Murphy. 32 minutes gone in the second half. Ireland lead 8 points to 5. And play now coming back to Kelly, linking up with Gibson, racing up to the penalty. Beautiful dummy! What a beautiful dummy! Yes, 10 yards inside England's half to Flynn, or to Walsh. Walsh running up to the 25, gives it to Casey. Casey's over under the post. What a beautiful try! This indeed was a magnificent try.
In athletics, Ireland played host early in the year when in March, Leopardstown Racecourse was the venue for the International Cross-Country Championships. 9 countries took part, and a ranked outsider took the individual honors. Almost 100 runners set out in the 7.5-mile run, 5 laps of Leopardstown Racecourse, with 2 jumps to negotiate on each lap. The team victory went to England, and the first Irishman home was Jim Hogan, who placed 5th. The individual winner was a surprise packet from Spain, the 5-foot-5-inch Francesco Arizmendi, who recorded Spain's first ever victory in these international championships. The track season began with 3 of our athletes ranked high on the international lists, Tom O'Riordan, Jim Hogan, and Noel Carroll. And Carroll, the most highly ranked, returned from the U.S. to his first home competition in College Park on July the 4th.
But it's Derek in front now, in a good position. Noel a little boxed in. I should imagine he'd try for the outside now. Colin Shillington second, Basil Clifford third, then McDonald, then Noel going up on the outside. Noel got into second place there after Derek McLean. Can he catch him? About 220 yards to go now. Derek looking very strong, very fresh, very fit. Noel with the arms going second. And it's Jackson gone up, the English runner in the third spot. But can Noel pass Basil or Derek McLean round the bend here into the stretch? Derek McLean, crowd standing up to their feet, cheering them to the line. Derek McLean just ahead. Can Carroll catch him? Coming up. Neck and neck to the tape, and it is Noel Carroll at the tape there. A great win for Noel.
1964 was above all else the year of the Tokyo Olympics. The Japanese demonstrated their superb efficiency and organizing ability, and with the aid of television, the games made their greatest ever impact on the world. Here now is a brief glimpse of some of the highlights which came to you via Telstar.
So, the famous New Zealander's kick, he exploded then. Now 5, 6, 7, 8 yards clear, and the rest looking like cab horses. Now way out in front, here comes Simpson. Simpson coming the long way around on the outside. Simpson in second place. It's now leading. Simpson second, Davis third, Moran fourth. And Davis in the... It's coming after Simpson, and Simpson tying up. Simpson was in the silver medal position. He's still there. Nell's going to be champion. It's Nell wins, and Simpson's going to lose it. Nell wins.
2 gold medals for New Zealand's Peter Snell, and here another Olympic giant, Ethiopian Abiba Bikila, winning his 2nd gold in the over 26 miles marathon.
Here's a man now who's led since about 6 miles, who's never looked like losing. One of the athletic performances of stamina, endurance, speed, courage and strength of all time.
Oh, for the days of lost youth. Well, not in the 70s, and in 1973 we introduced Sports Stadium, which has been going strong 5 to 6 hours every Saturday afternoon since then. And bringing you all the thrills of a hectic sporting schedule that included the Olympics at Munich and at Montreal, and the great rivalry at home between Kerry and Dublin.
Mickey Sullivan. And the referee penalises Dublin for a foul on Mickey Sullivan as he kicked the ball, and this free will be taken by Mikey Sheehy from about 40 yards up. And this will be the equaliser. Breezy ball against the wind. And oh, danger for Dublin there. The ball breaking loose on the wing. It's a goal! It's a goal by John Egan! A goal by John Egan! And there's the free being taken. Here's the ball coming down now. A ball dropped by Gail Driscoll. Across comes John Egan. Gets inside and takes his shot. Coming out to grab the ball now is Mikey Sheehy. Out towards Ogie Moran. Ogie cutting through the centre. Alan Larkin is after him. John Egan with the ball now. In front of the corner. And it's a goal. Or is it? Yes, it's a goal. It's a goal. It's a goal. Gerald Driscoll finishing into the net. And that is that. Some of the Dublin backs are going that he was inside the parallelogram, but here it is again, coming in, there it is, deflected in, and a fine goal by Gerald Driscoll. John Egan now with the ball, into Mikey Sheehy, back to John Egan. John Egan into Brendan Lynch, he's shot, and a save by Paddy Cullen. Fine save, two good saves by Paddy today, and the game is over, and Kerry are the champions. Kerry are the champions. They're worthy champions. There is no question whatever about it. And the Dubliners are the very first to congratulate them.
Charlie McCarthy. And the ball blocked down. Yes, it's him again. Out goes Noel Skeen. But he's beaten by Pat Hegarty. He gets it back to Mick Malone. Mick Malone across into the centre. And a shot that's low and hard. And a goal! Mick Malone it was who finished it. Mick Malone finishing it into the back of the net. And Dennis Collin. Lovely bit of feeling in the centre of the field by Dennis Collin. Lovely bit of hooking there by Frank Cummins. And a lovely bit of follow-up by Liam O'Brien. Liam O'Brien for Kilkenny up along the wing. Eddie Kerr grabbing that ball into his left hand. And away he goes up the wing. A shot from way out the field. And a goal! Oh, what a goal! What a goal! Ten to 15 points, 19 points to 18, and here come Cork again. Charlie McCarthy again. Ray Cummins, Cummins in front of the goal, and it's a goal. And it's Dennis Collin high from way out the field. Noel Skeen, and he tried to pass it past Charlie McCarthy. Charlie in possession now. Charlie in front of the goal mouth, and it is saved in the goal mouth. It's a goal. Three in for Kilkenny, and we make it about almost 18 minutes of the second half. On the 21-yard line, Eddie Kerr to take it. What would you do, chum? Would you be satisfied with the point? You've a long time to go, or would you try for a goal? Here he comes. He's going for a goal.
And he's got it. Damon Morrissey now for Kilkenny from his own 55. Again, not a long one. And it comes, however, to Frank Cummins. Frank Cummins going soaring up the field now. He's on the 50. It's 40. It's 30. It's 21. It's a shot. And it's a goal! It's a goal!
Paul Dillon and Ray Cummins. Charlie McCarthy out there too. Pat Dillon still there for Charlie. Gets it across into the centre. Going back as Pat Henderson. Wonderful recovery. Back to Frank Cummins. Playing one whale of a game in the centre of the field. And down it goes. Tony Maher back there. And here's Eddie Kerr. The shot and the lead for Kilkenny. Ball out to the centre of the field. Pat Henderson upfield to Eddie Kerr. A lovely touch over the head of the Corkman. And then getting the ball across to Kieran Purcell. Kieran Purcell from out the field, and it's another point for Kilkenny.
now, trying to get upfield. Trying to get up, in fact. He does both, and he gets the point. And the score is now, as it was a moment ago, Kilkenny, 3 goals and 24 points. Cork, 5 goals and 11, and there goes the final whistle. And Kilkenny are the All-Ireland champions.
The games began with the usual opening ceremony. Spectacular, colourful, noisy. And if the new Olympic boss, Lord Killannon, has his way, probably the last of its kind. A week later, the stadium was filled again for another ceremony. Memorial service for the murdered Israeli athletes, and the first of its kind. But an event which, in the current climate of things, may well be part of every future Olympic Games. As for the Olympic athlete...
Ronald McDonald in a new do.
Hey, maybe I could use a new hairstyle.
What do you think, Birdie?
Let me try a few things.
Uh-huh.
Cool. Yee! Tis I, Sir Ronald.
It's you.
Birdie, this style really is me.
Everybody loves it.
We sure do, Ronald.
Nice too.
Canoeing is a tremendous sport. But you've got to start early. A quick change, we head for the river, we hit the water. Then it's all action. But it's very tough and takes a lot out of you. And you need something to keep your energy levels up. Snickers satisfies me. Peanuts, chocolate really keeps me going.
It's a great challenge all the time. You're fighting the water and you're fighting yourself.
Satisfaction! Plenty of action, plenty of excitement.
Snickers really satisfies.
Remember what it was like in the days when you used to dream about having a car. You knew it was going to be great to drive in. Really well put together.
Young hearts are foolish.
And you hoped you'd always have friends who'd give you the backup and support you'd need.
Sure, it's no wonder so many people grew up to be Toyota drivers.
It's got to be
Toyota.
If you're looking for a spread with the right taste and the right price, look for Krona. It's got taste and price all wrapped up.
From the fishing villages on our shores they travel, through the ocean to rich waters. And it's there they find the choicest fish, which we prepare specially for you. Iyisk from Bird's Eye. Delicious fish fillets from the world's richest waters.
Tyler's for high fashion shoes. Model Girl, Fontana, Clodagh. All at Tyler's, of course.
And so to the 80s, the centenary year of the Gaelic Athletic Association. Stephen Roach wins the Tour de France and a World Championship. Two Triple Crown wins in rugby. John Tracy wins a silver medal in the Los Angeles Olympics. Eamon Coughlin wins a gold medal in the World Championships in Helsinki. Jack Charlton takes Ireland's soccer team to the European Championship finals. And in racing, great names like Shergar and Dawn Run hit the headlines. Great moments in time.
Young Waterford boy throwing kisses at the crowd, shaking his fist in the air, and not a bother on him. Winning the World International Cross Country Championships, as an old Waterford man down there in front of me cries, and I could almost do.
about 3 minutes left in the game. 3 minutes, 3 points. Richie Connor, Liam Curran's, Sean Lowry. And the referee awards a free into Offaly, dead straight in front of the goal. And it is on the 20-metre line, and surely Matt Connor will try, and I underline the word try, for a goal. Yes, he is. He's standing back. It looks as if he's... No, he's not. He's tapping it over the bar for a point. It looked as if he was clearing everything to run up and belt it over the bar. 2 points between them. Kerry 17, Offaly 15. Just under 3 minutes left in the game. 2 points between them. Is there still a goal left in the game? Charlie Nelligan. Paddy Lynch gets his hand to it, but it goes off his hand over the line. Line ball for Offaly. Offaly, the whole Offaly team up the field now. Every one of them. Martin Furlong is 20 yards out from his own goal. They're all up trying to do something. 17 to 15. Kerry back there trying to hold on. High ball in towards the goal mouth or the general direction thereof. Mikey Sheehy back to help. Mikey Sheehy now starting a movement that leads them into the attack. But Sean Lowry out to the wing. And brought down out there, Stephen Darby, and there is a free for the Offaly men with 2 minutes left in the game. Kerry leading by 2 points. And it looks as if they were winning the way the Offaly men are just diddling and dawdling there. And here they come. This is Liam Connor, the fullback. A high lobbing, dropping ball in towards the goal. A shot. And a goal! A goal! A goal for Offaly! There was a goal in the game! A goal! Oh, what a goal! And Offaly lead in the dying moments. Here it is! Here it is again! The ball coming in. And here's Liam Connor, who's come up from fullback. He sends a high ball in towards the goal now. It's fielded in there, and the ball is buried into the back of the net by the sub who came on, by the sub Seamus Darby, and the score is now Offaly 18, Kerry 17. 1 point in it, and less than a minute left of the game. Sensation of sensations. 115 to 17. And Offaly taking a free on the far side of the field. And they're in no hurry whatsoever up along the far wing. A bit of toe to hand over there on the far side, John Guinan. A little bit in. Ball picked up over on the far side. A high shot from way out the field. And it's gone. Oh, it's gone wide. It's gone wide. And the referee will be blowing the final whistle any second now. Quite a number of followers encroaching on the field. Offaly look as if they must now have won a most sensational All-Ireland. The kick out comes now into the 50-yard line. And the referee waves on the play, and here comes Kerry back again. But now it's broken up here, and it is Jerry Carroll with the ball. His kick is blocked down. Could now Kerry come back? There's a great comers back. And now the ball up the side of the field. Tom Smollett has it now. He's going in towards the goal mouth. He's gone right through. And he passes the ball in where Martin Furlong gets it. Martin is being tackled, but the ball has gone loose. Tom Smollett is in there. Martin Furlong has it. A pass is intercepted by Maggie Sheehy. There's the kick. It's high, and it drops into the hands of the waiting Sean Lowry. The game is over. Offaly are champions. That is one of the most sensational finals I have ever seen.
And although we're just 2 years into the 90s, we already have sporting headlines that will last us a lifetime. We've seen Ireland reach the finals of 2 World Cups in soccer and in rugby. In Gaelic games, we've seen Down bridge the gap between the 60s and the 90s with victories in the All-Ireland football final. We have seen that epic, that historic marathon between Dublin and Meath. And we've seen that event that engulfed the public imagination. Ireland stepping onto the World Cup stage for the first time in Italia 90.
Who's going to win the World Cup?
Ireland. Got all the Ireland team on me, well.
Carino, won by Butcher. Now here's Sheedy. Sheedy's won it back, and Sheedy shoots.
Thank you.
to pull the back four about a little bit on his runs. Whether it worked or not, I don't know, but we've got the goal.
I think it was a brilliant match. Only for Kevin Sheedy, we wouldn't have won.
Timopte against Bonner. Yep. David O'Leary is entrusted with the responsibility of taking the penalty that could send Ireland into the quarterfinals of the World Cup. This kick can decide it all. The nation holds its breath.
If World Cup hysteria dominated 1990, the Gaelic footballers of Dublin and Meath caught the imagination in 1991. It took four meetings before the first round tie was resolved.
Paul Curran had a goal opening. He was content with the point. Beggy. It's still possible. Foley. Into Gillick. A lot of poor marking by Dublin. And it's Tommy Dunn who's starting to run through the heart of Foley. I don't believe it. Foley has scored. The level. 50 seconds to go and Kevin Foley has scored his first goal of the championship. What a time.
Well, that was unbelievable. You know, the Meath forwards just walked through the Dublin defence. Dublin committed themselves completely and totally to attack. Their midfielders and half-backs have gone forward when they should have been defending closely. But there, here it is. You know, in fairness to me, they worked that score very well, and they're well-deserving. It was on the cards all the time.
It was a brilliant goal. Foley, the goal scorer. Superbly worked. Now they're going for a win, which we scarcely thought they were going to have 10 minutes ago. We had them completely written off.
And they have a chance, and the right men have it now, Flynn.
Kicking, and they're in front! Meath lead in this amazing game. We're into injury time. David Beggy's first score. A
What an incredible game it's been!
Meade went on to face down in a memorable final, and at last, the Sam Maguire returned to the north.
Towards James McCartan. Runs on towards Whitnell. Brendan Riley tries to get back goal side. Comes back again to James McCartan. Challenged by Brendan Riley and Kevin Foley. Fed inside to Greg Blaney. Mickey Linden has got the opportunity, and Barry Green!
Yeah, we were saying before the game how confident and cocky these down players are. Peter Whitner winning the ball, giving it to James the captain again, who's causing an awful lot of problems. But here we see Greg Blaney again, the experienced runner, gives a great ball to Mickey Linden, unselfishly gives the ball across the square, and there you have Barry Breen knocking in. A great goal for down.
Again, Barry Breen bursting through the centre. On to Eamon Burns, his midfield partner, on to Peter Whitner, on to Mickey Linden. There's another goal chance here. It's blocked down by a combination of Meade backs. Comes out somehow. Out to Greg Blaney. 20 metres out. Fires it in. Hits it over the bar. Blaney's first point. But he's been involved in so many of their good attacks. Very much the catalyst, setting up so many chances. And now an 11-point difference. Well, they're delighted over there. Colm O'Rourke has got an opening. They're firing well right now, Meade. Another scoring chance. Outside it comes to Bernard Flynn. Oh, it's stopped at point blank range by Neil Collins, the goalkeeper. That's a brilliant save, and it's going to be a free out. Best save of the match so far. A brilliant piece of goalkeeping by Neil Collins. Brown to David Beggy. Takes as well. Another good run by David Beggy. Setting up Colm O'Rourke. Bernard Flynn, the one who takes the pass. Absolutely straight and absolutely over. 3 points is Bernard Flynn's contribution. Now 7 points the difference. In towards Whitnell once more. Fine catch by Peter Whitnell. 2 goals and a point is tally in the semi-final. Nothing so far today. Having to live on crumbs virtually as Brendan Riley takes it out. And he floors James McCartan in the process. 3 is awarded, however. Tommy Dowd. He's got support inside if he can just get loose here. Brendan McKernan sticking to his man like a leech. However, it's into Hayes. There's a goal chance for Meath here. He buries it. The second goal of the match. This time for Meath. Will that resurrect their hopes of yet winning the Sam Maguire Cup? Because now there are just 5 points between the teams.
This is a great Meade goal there. Here we saw a great ball on the defence from a quick free by Brendan Riley. Tommy Dowd picked the ball up, shook up, got his free kick, took it quickly into Liam Hayes. And what an inspirational goal from Liam Hayes, the captain of the team. Here he takes his ball well, puts the goalkeeper the wrong way and puts the ball to the corner.
Alan Brown driving it down towards Brian Stafford, gathered by Colm O'Rourke. Matty McCabe is free wide on the left-hand side all this while, but he hits it inside instead to Bernard Flynn. Flynn trying to dodge round defenders. An assured kick, and he's put it over. That's 5 points now in all for Bernard Flynn. 4 points for Brian Stafford. And on the downside, Ross Carr with 5 points and Gary Mason with 4. Only 3 minutes to go. 4 points between the teams. Down the leaders, and it's Meade breaking through, and that's gone in, and it's gone over the bar off the boot of Bernard Flynn. Deadly dangerous in such a situation, set up by Tommy Dowd, finished in style. Well, they were looking for a goal. He really buried that one in that time as Dowd set it all up.
Yeah, this is again where we see the difference between the two teams. Meade getting half the chance now in the second half, and they're taking their scores very well.
Meade have possession, they have the free. Harnan the taker. Down suddenly static. Beggy looking for the goal that would level it up. Stopped. The referee says unfairly by DJ Cade. It's going to be a free in, and Brian Stafford can put this one over. But now it's Brian Stafford to convert possession into a score. Straight over. He's on 5 points for the afternoon. 116 now to 114. Under pressure. Alan Brown responding well. Mickey Linden trying to belt that ball forward. Brown once again to Terry Ferguson. They tried to engineer a score from somewhere to try and reclaim the prize that they last held in 1988. O'Rourke. And it's all over, and Down have won the All-Ireland. Down maintain a magnificent record. They've never lost an All-Ireland final, and the fans on Hill 16 are enjoying it enormously.
A month later, World Cup action returned to Ireland. This time, the rugby players showed their faces.
Diving pass to Keyes, and Keyes now to Curtis, and Curtis to Staples, and Staples kicks, and Clark's after this. Campisi barges him out of the way. Clark picks it up. Inside now is Hamilton. Gordon Hamilton is going for the line. Edges it across.
champion of the world.